So Meredith is a person that's trying to formulate like the big security issues in linguistics, and it's actually a very important topic. I've been trying to get her here as a speaker for a few years, I think, and I'm really happy that she finally came here. Now the slant of this talk actually makes me really interested too, because we all know that usability and security is not really the best of friends. Not that you know people do security well enough, they don't do usability well enough either. So all very interested in hearing this talk, and let's welcome Meredith.
Good morning, thank you all for coming. So this is going to be kind of a weird talk for me because I've been giving talks about grammar and security since about 2005. And this is going to be the first time I've ever given a Langsec talk where I don't talk about grammars at all. And that's because grammar is really only a small part of language. I mean, humans are basically language processing machines. And yet all we've really applied to security so far is just the syntax. So today, we're going to expand that view out a little bit. See, humans are really bad at reasoning about humans, not just other humans, but themselves too. Even really experienced designers get surprised all the time by how users respond to the interfaces that they develop. UX as a discipline has had to become data-driven because people fool themselves constantly about what they think they want, and only actual usage data can confirm whether the reasoning that drove your decisions was valid or flawed. In fact, it can't really even confirm. The best it can really do is hint. William Gibson famously said that the street finds its uses for things that uses the makers never intended. Tools that were never intended for contexts where security matters still end up getting used in life or death situations all the time. This might have been news when the Arab Spring broke out, but nobody has an excuse anymore. But even with security-sensitive use cases popping up everywhere from the Ukraine to Cupertino, we don't have the luxury of alpha-beta testing to empirically determine whether the tools we build provide the security properties we think they do. We have to get those right the first time. But there are still certain arguments that we keep having again and again and again, and I'm getting really tired of them. Security versus usability is probably the oldest of them. So when people talk about usability in a development context, they're usually talking about IDEs, code completion, stuff like that. Not here. In an enterprise context, a lot of the time you don't get to pick what language you're going to use, but you do have degrees of freedom about what libraries you use. That said, it turns out there's been next to no design research about what makes an API good or bad to use. There's a lot of opinion, but there hasn't been a lot of systematic research. There's been lots of work on graphical interfaces and next to none on text interfaces. However, some of these insights do translate. We like to talk about technical debt. So my friend Jonathan Corman, who is a UX designer, talks about UX design debt. And this translates into the API context. Sooner or later, you're going to have to stop adding methods to that API and refactor it into something that people can remember how to use without having to look it up all the time. So what we can talk about is what makes tools that are made from language easy or difficult to use. And I'm not going to be able to speak decisively about that. I don't think anybody can because, you know, taste matters, de gustibus est non disputandum. And there hasn't been a whole lot of research on what makes tools made from language easy or hard to use either. But we can draw insights from cognitive science and its applications in education. However, UX without user research is not UX. We absolutely must do empirical research on iterating towards usability. Nadim Kabaisi, when he started working on CryptoCat, started with usability, and he's been iterating towards security since 2011, and this is actually working. But it's still incredibly dangerous. People who are in a hostile environment who have a risky tool that they can use and a safe tool that they can't will use the risky tool every single time. If you're in Syria and your choice is between Facebook or not getting vital information to the people who need it to survive, Facebook wins. I have friends here in Stockholm who used to give tech support to Syrian rebels. I say used to because one by one, the Syrians fell off the face of the net. They're not on IRC anymore. We don't know where they are or what happened to them. Take a second, let that sink in. We have libraries that we know can provide security properties that people want and that people need. But as we'll see, the design of those libraries often makes it incredibly difficult to use them in a way that does provide those properties. That said, we can test tools that are built with these libraries in non-hostile environments, and we're actually going to take a look at how one team actually did. So what this implies is that we can iterate towards library usability in a non-hostile environment, and we bloody well should be. There's a tendency among security practitioners to look down on people who don't take security into account first and foremost when they write code. When we come in and we tell them, look guys, you need to be coding differently, there are two things that happen. Number one, they get upset, and number two, they still get it wrong. It's hard to stay mindful of multiple concerns at the same time, even when those concerns are not inherently in conflict. And I don't think that security and usability are inherently in conflict. But I do think that we as security practitioners need to take a step back and observe the choices that regular developers make, which concerns they work hard to satisfy and which ones they kick to the curb, and think about why they make the trade-offs that they do. If people use something that is terrible in almost all ways, it is because that tool is doing something that people need that other tools are not. PHP is really terrible for everything except getting up and running fast and not leaking. In PHP, there is less to configure than in any other language. You drop a template in the right directory and you're done. Hello world is a file containing the text hello world, and that's it. Furthermore, any state in PHP that you don't deliberately cache out to a database or a memory cache is just destroyed. Which is kind of hilarious because it means that on a systems level, PHP is actually more referentially transparent than, say, Java or Python. It also violates the REST principles less. I mean, it actually meets some of people's concerns about how code is supposed to behave. When you were a baby developer, you didn't know what a memory leak was. You know, and then maybe you wrote something in C that had pointers, and all of a sudden, after it ran for a couple of hours, your system shut down with a bus error. And, then you learned about memory leaks and how to do things about them. This is generally not a problem in a language where you're just flushing your state and getting rid of it every time somebody reloads a page. That said, PHP also violates nearly all of our concerns about how code is supposed to behave. But it turns out that getting up and running fast and not being difficult to maintain, if all you have to do is bounce the server, this matters a lot. And when management cares about speed, which in today's business environment, it's kind of hard not to, your most important metric as a developer is how fast can you get unblocked when you're blocked on something. And when you've got an incredibly large user base of people who have gotten up and running quickly and then managed to get stuck in the exact same place that you got stuck, chances are somebody has already answered your question on Stack Overflow. So FX talked a little bit about composability. I'm going to get into that a little bit more. If you cannot rely on what a piece of software does, then that software is not secure. But composability goes farther than that. Computation has to be composable in order to get the right answer in the first place. If you've got process one that transforms A into B, and process two that transforms B into C, then you can compose them sequentially into a system that transforms A into C, but only if the processes operate in that order. If the second process goes to transform B into C, and there's no B there yet, but process two just grabs whatever data it sees and assumes that that's a B, all bets are off. And if a third-party adversary put that data there, process two and the entire environment it's running on is in trouble. Unless, of course, process two has some way to recognize, yes, that really is a B, and doesn't just treat it as one. So if you have two computations that interact, you know, one that produces data that the other consumes, or you know, two computations that are writing data to the same location, they're only composable if they don't violate each other's assumptions. And this is why in Langsec we talk about boundaries of competence. Boundaries of competence are those points of interaction where assumptions that must not be violated can be violated if one of the actors is malicious or even just sloppy. Now, keeping track of a lot of assumptions is hard. I mean, think about multitasking. You know, you can't keep too many concerns in your head without driving yourself insane. And so the biggest problem that API designers face is how to enable developers to manage that state without going crazy. And although we don't have any silver bullets, we do know a few things about how brains work that can inform those design decisions. So let's talk about those. So you're probably already familiar with the concept of fluency with a language. If you're fluent in a language, then you find it easy to understand and express things in that language. It doesn't take a lot of work. So processing fluency refers to how much work it takes to process information. The paper referenced there, Uniting the Tribes of Fluency to Form a Metacognitive Nation, is actually a meta-analysis of many, many studies dating back to the 1950s on different kinds of fluency. So processing fluency refers to how much work it takes to process information. It's a completely subjective thing. And there are several kinds of processing fluency. It breaks apart into multiple components. And Alter and Oppenheimer do talk about several more that that I won't be discussing here. But the ones that we care about, number one, perceptual fluency. How easy is it to recognize a piece of information, particularly based on what it looks like? Visual fluency. If two pieces of information look too similar, like method names or option names, then perceptual fluency is going to suffer for it. Number two is retrieval fluency. How easy is it to remember a piece of information once you've learned it? How easy is it to call it back up from memory? Now, this is affected by a couple of different cognitive biases, essentially structural heuristics that are baked into our brains, things that evolved, the heuristics that evolved along with us. Particularly recency bias. That's your tendency to remember the most recent thing that you encountered, along with the availability heuristic. That's your tendency to stop thinking as soon as you remember whatever that most recent thing was. So you can see how very quickly this becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. You learn something the wrong way once, and you keep doing it the wrong way until you force yourself to stop in your tracks, turn around, and go a different way. Number three is decision fluency. How easy is it to make a decision? If you have too many options, or if you have options that are difficult to tell apart, you know, if you can't really tell which choice you're actually going to end up making just because they seem so similar, that makes it really hard to make decisions at all, much less the right ones. So another concept that's going to come into play here is recognition vocabulary. So in natural language, recognition vocabulary is those words that you already know the meanings of and can recognize immediately. It's also known as sight vocabulary. And of course, in natural language, since, for instance, English and Swedish and German and Dutch, all evolved from from the same ancestor language. You have a little bit of recognition vocabulary in languages that you don't even necessarily speak. And this kind of applies to programming languages as well. I mean, I have never written a word of C sharp, I've never written a line of C sharp, but I've written enough Java that I can read it reasonably well. Now, in natural language, homonyms, words that are spelled the same and sound the same but have different meanings, those can cause confusion. This means that it's really important to think about what you name things. I actually had an example of this come up at work yesterday. So I work for Nuance Communications, and I do natural language processing stuff. And so we've got this, we've got this system that pulls a bunch of features out of documents. And one of the things it does on the way towards doing that is, of course, parsing the natural language. So, we've got this kind of God object class that that needs to get refactored into, one thing that holds immutable data and another thing that has mutable data. So I was thinking about what to name it. So for the immutable, for the immutable one, I'm thinking, okay, how about parser model? And for the mutable one, how about per parse context? So I brought this up on the status call yesterday. And I'm like, I don't know if I like per parse context all that much. That's kind of long. I don't want to have to type that over and over again. My boss said, well, how about just calling it parse context? And one of my coworkers said, oh God, no, that sounds like you're parsing a context. And she's absolutely right. Because availability heuristic. As a word, parse is more available as a verb than as a noun. You are more likely to encounter it being used as a verb. And we don't want future maintainers, the poor bastards that are going to have to maintain this somewhere down the line, to jump to the conclusion that it's a verb here. So we use morphology to fight the availability heuristic. We add a preposition because the preposition per is almost always followed by a noun. But being too specific can also cause confusion. In the .NET best practices, there's a thing about URL path encode. So you would think that a function called URL path encode would encode a URL, right? Actually, as it turns out, URL path encode only encodes a URL up until the question mark, because everything after that is the query. But people who are writing software have this mental model of a full URL as the fully qualified path to the resource it locates. And so Microsoft had to call this out specifically in the ASP.NET best practices, because so many people were opening themselves up to cross-site scripting because they were only encoding the path of the URL and not the query parameters, because they thought they were using the right thing because of what it was named, and the name was misleading. Also, chunking. So people tend to remember things in groups. They categorize things that they learn by the extent to which those things are interrelated. But if there are too many similar elements in a group, then retrieval fluency suffers. Unless you have some way to organize those elements into smaller and more closely related clusters and then nest those clusters into some kind of meaningful structure, you're going to have a hard time even remembering roughly how many elements there were. So back in 1956, a guy named George Miller, who had been reading some of Claude Shannon's work on information theory, took a look at, when people need to distinguish between things, you can think of that as a one-bit decision. So how much working memory, do people seem to have for being able to, to make distinctions between things? And the effective working limit empirically seems to be somewhere between 5 and 9. So that's why he called his paper the magical number 7 ±2. And so the implications for large namespaces out of this should be pretty obvious. And yes, this completely contradicts the aphorism flat is better than nested from the Zen of Python. But I mean, look at the end of the Zend of Python, even they think we should be using more namespaces. Now, if you flip this around, so instead of flat hierarchies, you know, deep inheritance hierarchies, like in certain Java libraries that I won't name, struts, that creates a related problem. Sure, you know, everything's organized, that's great, but the path going back to the root is so long that it becomes incredibly difficult to remember which methods came from which superclass or which super interface. And so it's really worth taking a look as well at whether implementing too many interfaces, which is a thing that totally happens in Java and other interface-based languages, or for that matter, using too many mix-ins in, say, Ruby or Scala, you know, whether that creates problems too, whether that makes it difficult to keep track of where functionality is coming from. So, we haven't talked about semantics much in Langsec at all. Now we're going to start doing that. Some advice that I've often heard when, you know, designing a library or designing a tool is write the man page first. This is good advice, but all too often, people end up sort of mentally translating that as come up with the syntax first, and that's not quite what it means. So every problem that you might have to solve has some domain. You know, problem domain, that's a phrase. There are things that factor into that problem, and there are things that do not affect that problem at all. Every problem also has a range. So you probably heard those terms in high school algebra class back when you learned about functions. We're talking about functions here too. It's the exact same deal. It might not be arithmetic. You know, we're talking about, algebraic data types as it happens. But it's functionally the same thing. The side effects of what a computation does are part of its range. What are the effects when a procedure succeeds? But just as importantly, what are the effects when a procedure fails? So when you're designing from a mindset of semantics, the first thing you do is you create a mental model of the mapping between the domain and the range. That mapping is a function. Once you have that mental model, then you can start writing the syntax. And you use the knowledge that you have about the domain in order to describe those mappings. Software that gets written for, you know, the automotive industry is going to have different naming conventions from software that gets written for, say, the aviation industry, simply because they're dealing with different problems. They have different jargon, you know, they have different ways of talking about things. And tools and libraries that are built to address those concerns need to have domain meaningful syntax in order to be useful to people who are trying to solve problems in those domains. And so I think this is actually part of why security-related libraries presents such a challenge for people who are trying to solve problems in other domains, because they just don't have the mental model of what the security domain even is. So one of the things that we might want to think about is how can we translate the elements of our domain that are meaningful in other domains into those domains such that it makes sense. So we still only have a rough idea of what makes a good API. But if we restrict bad to fails to provide users with the security guarantees it promises, there's actually been some science on that. So 2 years ago, this all-star team out of the University of Texas and Stanford did a really, really thorough review of how both applications and other libraries use SSL implementations. They looked at OpenSSL and GNU TLS. They also looked at middleware. They looked at data transport libraries like curl and Apache's HTTP client. And they also looked at modules that are part of languages, HTTP lib and URL lib in Python, as well as some of the PHP like socket interfaces. And what they found was everybody is doing it wrong. And I'm not talking just, you know, sheer numbers, everybody. You know, the umpty billion people out there who are building storefronts on top of Drupal. I mean, those people were certainly vulnerable too. I mean, they looked at 14 different shopping cart modules. And they found a whole two of them that had cert validation turned on. The other 12 had it completely disabled. No certificate validation whatsoever. The two that did have it turn on, those were both for Google Checkout, and Google Checkout doesn't exist anymore. It shut down last year. It was replaced with Google Wallet, and although Google Wallet does require HTTPS if you're going to be sending things like credit card numbers around, Google Wallet doesn't have any way to know whether that connection has been man in the middle or not. But it really is worse than that. By everybody, we're talking about things like the Amazon EC2 Java library, Android push notifications, Amazon flexible payments, every API PayPal had, everything, all of them. I spent a good bit of time, you know, going and reviewing at least the open source stuff that they discussed, and most of it has been fixed. Not all, though. So you'd think that verify this SSL certificate would be a yes or no question. Let's talk about curl. So there's this option in curl called curl opt SSL verify host. You'd think that would be a Boolean value, right? Yes or no, true or false. However, in order for curl opt SSL verify host to do anything at all useful, that value actually has to be set to 2. So, and if it's set to 2, all it does is it checks that the common name in the certificate matches the host name of the server that sent it to you. That is literally all it does. Only host name validation, nothing else. Now, curl is currently on version 7.38.0. That came out about a week and a half ago. In version 7.28.0, the default behavior was if curl opt SSL verify host was set to 1, then it would check to see that there was a common name in the cert. That's all. So if you set the value to true, that equals 1. So it would give you a thumbs up. Yep, there's a common name in that thar cert. 7.28.1 deployed a partial fix to this in November 2012. Now if curl opt SSL verify host is set to 1, it will throw an error. There have been 10 minor version bumps and a point release in almost 2 years, and the documentation still says, we're going to deprecate this eventually, and then 1 will behave just like 2. I want to know when eventually is, because 2 years is just far too long for this to be going on. But it gets worse. There is another option that affects how curl opt SSL verify host behaves, and it works differently depending on what SSL library you build curl against. So there's this other option called curl opt SSL verify peer, and it's a Boolean. So it defaults to true, but if somebody switches it off for whatever reason, curl doesn't check that the cert is authentic anymore. It just checks that the names match. So you know, it doesn't bother to authenticate it against the PKI. All it does is, you know, if you've got curl-opt SSL verify peer is false, and curl-opt SSL verify host is set to 2, then great. You got to assert that where the name matches the server that sent it to you, but you have absolutely no idea whatsoever that it's valid. Now that's with OpenSSL. You build against NSS and set verify peer to false, and curl behaves as if curl opt SSL verify host was also set to 0. Curl will not even check that the host name matches the common name. It will pass pass everything through as if and just set up the SSL connection like nothing ever was wrong, and your user is never going to know. And I think that naming conventions are really working against us here, because okay, yes, all of us who have read RFC 5246, which is the RFC for TLS, we know that in TLS everybody is a peer. But if you haven't read RFC 5246, if you're just an average developer, a peer is another client like you. A host is a server. So why would you care what peers are going to be presenting to you if you're not going to be talking to peers? Except, you know, that's a mistaken assumption. But unfortunately, it's a mistaken assumption that that we've allowed to perpetuate itself, because we need to, you know, we need to recognize that people who don't have our context are not going to interpret the things we build with that context in mind. We're going to have to figure out how to talk to them. So, I mean, why would you ever want to only check that a host and common name match and not check that the cert is authentic? I mean, in development, you might use a self-signed cert to get your code working before you shell out good money for a cert. You know, again, the crucial metric is time to unblock. But the thing that is blocking you is actually these libraries, because they've established an invalid mapping between the domain and the range. So the domain consists of certificates and certificate authorities. Those are the inputs. And then the range, which is the set of possible outputs when you check the authenticity of a cert, that has at least 4 possibilities. It could have an invalid, the certificate could have an invalid signature, and that means you're done, fail closed. Don't let any other data through. It could be valid but self-signed, in which case you can't authenticate it against the PKI. But do you care about that? That's your decision. But the library is making it for you. Similarly, a certificate could have a valid signature that chains back to a root that you don't have. This actually happened to me about 2 weeks ago when I went to pay my Belgian taxes online for the first time. I actually had to go and download from the Belgian tax authorities a CA and install it in my browser to be able to pay my taxes. Or, fourth option, a certificate could have a valid signature and a valid trust chain back to the root. So it would be really nice to know what actually happened, which of these 4 possibilities or even others. Instead of reporting that back so that developers can decide which subset of the range that should constitute failure for the domain that they're working in, and then predicated on that, whether they should fail open or fail closed, we have libraries, we have middleware libraries that are forcing developers to fail open in order to make any development progress at all. This is a problem, because when you're under time pressure, good luck remembering to switch that back to fail closed. So, all right, fine, you might say. Screw these middleware libraries. I'm smart, I'll use OpenSSL all by itself. Now you have even more problems, because instead of a library managing these responses for you badly, now you have to manage them yourself. So, going back to the Georgiev and Bonnet paper, in OpenSSL, SSL Connect sets an error value if the chain of trust verification fails. However, if there is no callback, SSL Connect will still succeed as long as the error is not a parsing error. So if you only check the return value, you don't know what actually happened. You have to call SSL get verify result because the library stashes whatever the error came up during verification in this in a pointer that get verify result goes and accesses for you. And you still have to validate the host name yourself. That's still your problem. OpenSSL is not going to do that for you, so you have to remember to do that. And that means dealing with X509 libraries, and may God have mercy on your soul. And it's not like GNU TLS is any better. Lynx, the text-based web browser, the developers of Lynx misunderstood GNU TLS so badly that all they were doing was taking a look at the return value from the connect method, which for most errors will return a negative value, but for other errors, it only returns a zero, which looks exactly like success. And so they were looking at, their logic was, okay, if the return value is negative, then we'll check the TLS status code. The TLS status code is analogous to the error value that OpenSSL sets. And they didn't just write one check for the GNU TLS cert sign or not found error. There were two of them. However, neither one was reached unless the return value was negative. And zero is not negative. So if you had a self-signed cert, the return value was zero, and you never bothered to check whether sign or not found happened. It was just merely validating self-signed certs and proceeding along its merry way as if self-signed was fine. And, in a lot of cases, self-signed is fine. But how do they know? How do they know what your use case is? So there's a thing people talk about called choice paralysis. When you have too many choices to make, that's very paralyzing. You're not sure which one to make first. You're not sure which one is most important. Furthermore, inconsistent error reporting deludes people into thinking that they're safe when they're not. On the other hand, it's also frustrating when you have too few choices provided to you. If you have to, in order to get your work done, you're going to turn off all of the security features that are available to you. And if you don't have time to go turn them back on, they're not going to get turned back on. So if you want your library to be fully functional, you need to make it express the circumstances that have resulted from its actions in a consistent fashion. And then let developers make the choice from there. And for pity's sake, stop hiding error codes behind what look like successful return values. Humans can only observe the principle of full recognition before processing if they know where to find what they have to recognize. And if you make them look in more than one place, you're setting them up for failure. But things do get better. I do a lot of C++ development, and the STL has gotten a lot better since the old SGI days. And they had to make some serious, like, low-level changes to C++ in order to support the changes that they ended up making to the STL. Move constructors and move assignment, which are the two components of move semantics, which means, okay, I'm I'm going to move construct an object from another object. So I'm going to rip all of the guts out of that object, move them into myself, and reset the object that I took the guts from to newly initialized. So they had to add an entirely new kind of reference to the entire freaking language to make that happen. That's why they introduced R value references, references to the right-hand side of an assignment operation. But they did it. I mean, that was a huge amount of work, but they did it, and it makes threading so much less of a hassle now. Furthermore, they weren't afraid to deprecate things. Not just autopointer, they deprecated entire freaking idioms. The addition of move semantics deprecated out idioms that C++ users had to develop in order to work around the shortcomings of the language and had just become resigned to. In C++98 or C++03, if you need to get rid of extra capacity in a container, fastest way to do that is to swap that container with a temporary copy of itself. That's bullshit. There also used to be this this pattern where if you had a really heavy class, like with a lot of data members, and you needed to copy construct it, like ever, that takes a long time. So, if a temporary value had to get initialized, you could get around that speed hit by making a heavy class inherit from a small base class that was otherwise completely useless. So you were deep sixing your own processing fluency and that of everyone who used your work by having to add this extra layer of indirection to get around to get around a shortcoming in the language. And they fixed that. But that's a language. Let's actually talk about a security library. Let's talk about GPG. So GNUPG made easy. Yeah, right. So they made a lot of the same mistakes that OpenSSL did. GPGME has its own weird, squirrely IO abstraction layer, kind of like the OpenSSL bio. You have to set up this context god object first. Keys and usernames get lumped. These are disparate data types. They don't have the same properties, but they still get lumped together under a god struct of their own where certain members are only valid for certain types. Now, error handling is a little bit better insofar as most functions return an error type, GPGME error T. But on the other hand, all of the operations that you actually care about, like decryption or signing, so if you've got a GPG op foo, there's a corresponding GPG op foo result function that returns a GPGME foo result T. And that pointer doesn't actually contain the result. The result is actually in the context. And the only way to get it out of the context is to use the IO abstraction layer functions that recapitulate the C standard IO library. And if you happen to do anything else to the context before pulling out that result T, bye-bye data. Like, you didn't need to know who that message was encrypted to, right? I mean, like, does that matter? But, I mean, Werner Koch designed this API in 2000, and it's also C. So Python has to be better, right? Not really. So PyGPGME came out in January 2006. And as you can see, it's really tightly coupled to the GPGME API. You've still got all this nonsense about contexts, and everything happens through the context. A lot of the boilerplate is hidden, but it's still the same. It's still the same ugly, difficult to reason about idiom. It's also not very Pythonic. And there's an older library that called Pyme that also binds to the GPGME C API, and it's just about as bad. So maybe binding is the problem. Is it better if we wrap GPG? Maybe. I mean, I end up having the same kinds of problems with build systems all the time. You know, people write build systems assuming that the way that they do it is the way that every right-thinking person ought to do it. And then, you know, you end up having to deal with legacy code, and you know, you're unable to migrate away from make because the assumptions that somebody made when they wrote the original make file don't conform to the assumptions that the build system makes. You know, and there are similar problems here. GPG.py is, you know, has its own very particular opinions about you know, what you name your key rings and where you keep them. What happens if, you know, you don't want the people that are going to seize your laptop on the way through the airport to know that there's a key ring even there? You know, for that matter, it fixes you to certain options for various operations and just leaves a bunch of stuff out. And then there's things like this. Were they necessarily all that right thinking? I mean, who left that comment and where? Who does put unit tests in a try except block which catches all exceptions? One of the previous GPG developers did. The person who wrote that comment is the person who fixed it. So last year, Isis Lovecraft from the Tor project went and rewrote GPG.py. The interface surface is actually smaller now thanks to the refactoring. There are fewer methods to have to think about, but everything is, you know, all of the options that you have are organized in a nice Pythonic way. Keyword arguments, that's what Python is for. That's, people are no longer having, people who are trying to use PGP from within Python are no longer having to context shift between a Pythonic mindset and a C mindset. This is probably the best thing that has ever happened to PGP. Thank you, Isis. I love you so hard. So in conclusion, there are a lot of tasks for which appearing to have accomplished something is just as good as having actually accomplished it. If you're using MongoDB for your data storage, you've already made that trade-off. This is manifestly not the case for APIs. So as a result, you need to not just make it easy to do what you want to do, but difficult to use it wrong. APIs need to actively be difficult to use in ways that are dangerous to developers, because those dangers can and will propagate out to the end users. We've learned some very hard lessons about what makes APIs difficult to use correctly. We're getting better at making APIs easier to use correctly. And now we need to figure out how to make them hard to use wrong. So I had a lot of help from people in getting this talk together. My friend Scry on Twitter, she's a UX developer up in Portland. Jonathan Corman, who I mentioned earlier. Earlier this week, I was in Westeros for the Software Language Engineering Conference. They had an amazing panel on teaching people how to build languages, particularly domain-specific languages, that compose. Massimo Tisi has some great papers. Eric Walkingshaw was there, Martin Irwig was not, but Eric was the one who pointed me at semantics-driven development, and I want to take that and run with it as far as we can go. Thank you very much to the open source developers who made Content Aware Phil for the GIMP. Pictures were all from Paramount. And last, I'd actually like to thank my sisters. They're both elementary school teachers. They have to explain things to six-year-olds. They have to explain things to people who have no context because they're too young to have it. If they can explain things to a six-year-old, they can explain it to anybody. So they're the people that I look to for inspiration. And thank you all for coming.
And Thank you, Meredith. It feels like there's a need for like a metric on how inappropriate something is, not just how secure it is or how well tested it is, but also how inappropriate it is to use it, or appropriate, hopefully.
Well, I guess the question there is kind of how you define appropriate. Off the top of my head, I mean, I go back to, you know, Sir Tony Hoare's remark about how it is important for software to do what its user, you know, what its users want it to do, but it is even more important for software to not do what its users don't want it to do. So I guess that's how I look at appropriateness. The question then sort of becomes, how do we find that out from people? How do we ask them those questions? And regarding questions, you know, by the way, this is a wide open area. There are more questions than there are answers here. There are no dumb questions, only open ones. So please, let's get some out. What should we be thinking about?
Well, the other question that I really had was, you had a lot of examples from SSL libraries. Could
yes.
it be that SSL is what is actually inappropriate that is leading to this?
Well, I mean, I certainly think that there are ways that, you know, that there are names that we have given to actors in an SSL handshake, and an SSL conversation that are not particularly informative to people who aren't thinking about the participants in an SSL conversation as peers. I don't know. It's a difficult question. I mean, I wish John Callis were here because this is something that he thinks about a lot.
Because maybe if we rethink how we think about SSL, what names we use when we're talking about the protocol SSL, then maybe all the APIs will follow.
That could be the start. I mean, after all, I mean, if you're going to write a library, and you know you're deep in the context of you know this RFC that I'm trying to implement, you know, it kind of makes sense to just name everything after how it's named in the spec. But then you're so close to it that it's difficult to think about how other people are going to think about you know what those terms mean.
True. So, we have questions in the audience?
Sergey.
I have a microphone for you.
And I saw your question too. I just saw Sergey first, but I'll add. Yeah. But.
So, speaking of characterizing the kind of language failures, right? Is there a term for the double equals versus single equals in C? Which has bedeviled us since forever. Do we know what class of failure this is cognitively?
I mean, it seems kind of like a homonym issue, right? I mean, because when you're handwriting down, or actually, no, I know what it is. It's actually okay. So there's this term in natural language called false friends, right? So in German. The word for poison is gift.
Same in Swedish.
If you're and if you're an English speaker, that assumption takes you by surprise. So, if you're an arithmetic speaker who is learning C, and you're used to a single equals meaning equals, you know, learning that's a you know. A single equals mark meaning assignment is a false friend.
I see.
You had a question.
Also, I would add that married and poison are homonyms in Swedish.
How do you say it?
Gift.
Okay.
Oh, we had one more question here?
Yes.
So, I'm a Java developer, and one issue which often comes across is that you have to interface one API, and that API will go down into a web service layer. that will eventually go down into an HTTP layer, which eventually will go into the SSL layer. So one issue which often comes across is that you need to do a specific change for that specific SSL connection, and it's seven layers, at least four layers down from where you are, and you typically end up with people changing the global security settings, because if it is possible, it's at least very, very hard to traverse all these layers of abstractions. So my question is really if there is any sort of ideas on how to avoid this kind of huge abstractions.
So going back to boundaries of competence for a moment, I was talking earlier about how when libraries restrict your degrees of freedom too much, those are assumptions that the libraries are making for you. And so yeah, I mean that is a good question. How do we expose the functionality that needs to be able to be changed from higher up without causing too many without causing too many knock-on effects, not just in not just in the global system state, but also in the HTTP layer, in the middleware layer. And the only thing I can really think of up off the top of my head is another little aphorism from the Zen of Python: explicit is better than implicit. We need to figure out how to make the security assumptions that exist at different layers of abstraction more legible to end developers, as it were, to the people who are programming at the application layer. But unfortunately, I don't have any clever ideas yet about how to actually achieve that. So one of you perhaps could.
We have more questions? Someone back here? Do you mind passing that in? No, thank you.
Hey, so one thing that happens a lot is we've got like a solution in one domain, mm-hmm. and then we put it into another domain and use it there. I think my favorite example is right now I've been recently working on an LED control project that uses the open sound control protocol, for mm-hmm. instance, to control lighting. Mm-hmm. So how do we deal with the fact that domains shift and that solutions that start in one domain often end up in another?
So the term that popped to mind, and I'm going to have to unpack this, is actually impedance matching. The concept of impedance in electronics is essentially resistance to flow. Some ideas translate, some don't. And so when we can identify the ideas that do translate, obviously those are useful. But then when we try to stretch the metaphor too far, things break. Translating is hard. This is why these are open questions. I mean, I'm more trying to get everyone else thinking about this because I can't solve this all myself. We're not very good at translating from one human language to another, particularly rigorously. I wonder whether more constrained domains might be easier to translate. But I think that's going to mean coming up with a way to talk about that. I mean, we're talking about inventing meta languages here. We're talking about inventing ways to talk about what we're talking about in software. I don't think that was a very good answer, but.
Okay, do we have any more questions? Because I was thinking about the question with abstraction layers. There must be at least some appropriate amount of abstraction layers, because currently people use as many abstraction layers as the language wants you to use, not what's appropriate or not.
That's true, and certain languages do constrain you a good bit more than others. on that front. And it occurs to me, actually, that the ways that, languages themselves use parts of speech, as it were, affects this. Steve Yeagy has this wonderful blog post. I can't remember the first two words of it, but it's something something in the kingdom of nouns.
I love it.
And if you like beating on Java, it's a wonderful post for that, because he tells this story of this magical kingdom where where the nouns are the first class citizens and verbs are the slaves of nouns, and they can't go anywhere without being attached to a noun. And so of course this is just a very long built up analogy for how every freaking thing in Java is a factory. And I do think that, trying to think about things in terms of nouns that make things happen as opposed to verbs being applied to nouns is counterintuitive, to our understanding of natural language, because, in natural language, an actor does a thing to a subject, or sometimes, the actor doesn't actually exist. When it's raining, who's it? So, certainly the construction of a language will have some impact on what layers of abstraction it ends up requiring. So I hope we get away from Java as fast as we possibly can.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much, Meredith.